So logistics is basically about how do I move a lot of physical goods from point A to point B. Also, how am I going to service my customer? How am I going to support them? And so a lot depends on the variables shown here. Now, the thing about the big fight regarding manufacturers and also resellers is information. For example, high tech, there's a lot of information you have to give. And so the question is who controls the information? Who does the messaging to the customer? So as you can see, it ties in with promotion and the other factors. Or am I something more about logistics, meaning I have to get hundreds of millions of these things out there? So all of a sudden, all the shipping and everything else, logistics is a really big deal. If you talk about FedEx, their entire business is about logistics. Not only that, even something like GoPro is logistics. On the other hand, if I'm talking about like Windows 10, okay, now it's not so much about the logistics of getting it in everyone's hands. It has more to do with educating people and telling the information and letting them steer the conversation of what Windows 10 is actually going to be about. So in terms of making a decision of how do I go about setting up my distribution channel, naturally, if I have a high demand for information, I'm going to be more hands-on. It's going to slant more towards people. On the other hand, if it's not, then I can get away with middlemen or just doing it digitally. Now, resellers versus digital. Now, remember, resellers is not I buy something and then sell it again. Resellers are basically your middlemen. And the thing about digital is you can get rid of a lot of the costs. Some of these are uncertain. Like, for example, if I'm selling something off of my website. Now the question is like an inventory. Do I have my inventory stacked up somewhere where I'm actually shipping it out? Or do I contact somebody else? And they're actually controlling the logistics. And that's why some of this is unknown, like in terms of distribution. The thing is, again, having a middleman, in some ways it's great because it takes that whole huge headache and everything involved with selling off your hands. On the other hand, how much control do you have over the situation and how much can you influence it by? And so the thing is when we look at the driving forces of this, a lot comes from customers. Customers are better informed, they're better educated, they have greater demand. Logistics is taken for granted now. I just expect it to be overnight. And that's because the bar is raised with all these competition between companies. But what you see is that you get a lot of fighting between your channels and your suppliers. The things to consider in this are things like legal, resource constraints, and barriers to exit or entry. So the question becomes, do I want to look at direct channels, and here are examples of direct channels, or do I want to get buy-in in direct channels? There are companies out there, for example, there's a company, TSA Research. They're a company of 70 geeky chemists, and all they do is use their research and convert it to products, but do they actually want to go through the process of production and everything else? No, they just hand it off. They just get a license, and so they can just sit back. And so there are advantages to doing it that way. The thing about the situation is how do you have influence over a situation? How much do you want to control it? And then once I control it, how much power do I have over the situation? And yeah, they're closely related, but they are a little bit different. And that's that some of you, when you go out into industry, will become program managers. As a program manager, you're in charge of a product and getting that product out. But you actually have no one reporting to you. You have a team from the engineering department that does the technical stuff. You've got a team from manufacturing that's going to tell you how this is going to be manufactured. You have a team from quality assurance and so on and so forth. So, in effect, you don't have control over the situation. You do, though, have a certain amount of power. And the reason why is their salaries and everything else get paid out of your budget. And so, as you can see, this is what I'm referring to. And so the question becomes is, how do you resolve these conflicts? Because that's one of the biggest challenges in managing this whole complex system of distribution. The thing is, intermediaries and manufacturers have different views of each other. And guess what? Each of them thinks of the center of the universe, and each of them just thinks that the other one is less important. And so the manufacturers just think, you're just a middleman. He should be erased. He said, we can just do it straight from here. And then the intermediaries think, you manufacturers, all you know how to do is turn cranks. You have no idea how to touch customers and how to talk to them. And so if you create excess value, though, each of them thinks, well, it should go to me. And the big thing is each of them has a different profit model. When you think about a manufacturer, they have a lot of overhead. They have a lot of fixed costs. And the reason why is because they bought all these machines, they set up this factory and everything else. So what they're driven by is, look, we have to spend a lot of money to get to this point. So what we need you to do is to pump out and sell a lot of these things. And so this is where you start hitting things like economies of scale. The more you make, the cheaper it gets. And so they want more volume. On the other hand, a distributor, it's like, well, no, we don't have as much overhead as they do. So we're actually more interested in it. And like, I'm a target. What am I interested in? I'm interested in, okay, every one of these, what's the most amount of profit I can make off of each and every one? And so they're margin driven. They want things they're going to be able to sell for a lot of money. For example, what do people fight over in a reseller? They fight over shelf space. And so if I can't make a lot of profit off of each and every item, guess what? You're off the shelf and I'm going to put something there that I can make more profit on. The question is it the reseller who drives customer behavior? And so now you're talking about the value of the brand, the intensity of the distribution, switching costs. The thing is, my reseller, like if I'm used to buying something at Walmart, there's a switching cost, there's a mental switching cost associated with it. Or if I buy something, say a part for cars, well, guess what? If I switch vendors, now I'm going to have to requalify them and everything else. So switching costs actually becomes a very big issue in terms of resellers. And also support programs. Like a lot of companies regret. They just said, you know something, we're going to go cheap. These guys are doing this for so much cheaper. This isn't all that important. Then you do that and you find out, oh, wait a minute. These guys don't support us like they do. It's crappy. Oh, I would actually pay the extra money for the fewer headaches. And so this goes into power, and that's how much reward we can give. Like, for example, in terms of extra money made, it's like, who gets it? Where does it go to? Do I control that? And essentially, who's in charge? And the thing is, if you have a program, you have a lot of power. And you have a lot of demand, then typically you're going to have a very tight relationship with the company that you're working with. And that's because you own the cards and they don't really have any say in it. Here's some of the control schemes that companies use, and that's that they may not have purchased, but they're contractually obligated to you, like in franchises. They're part of your vertical integration. But one thing about vertical integration is you always start to wonder, wait a minute, should I just make this or should I buy it from them? And also you can make explicit partnerships where the television program Duck Dynasty sells all their stuff in Walmart. Although I'm still stunned why anybody wants a Duck Dynasty towel. And so in terms of your horizontals are going to fight. And the thing is, there's a lot of options. There's a lot of way to do things. And everybody is very cognizant if you show any favoritism to somebody else. And that's a problem. And so how do I separate these fights? How do I keep them separated? Yes. But what we do is we can separate brands according to channels, and that's that. For example, I could have a high-end channel. Guess what? You're going to sell the luxury products, you're going to sell the commodity products, or you're going to sell the products related to medicine, you're going to sell the products related to defense. You try to keep them separate. You try to control the distribution intensity, and that's that. You decide whether or not they're going to be general or whether or not they're going to be specific. You set the boundaries between each of those channels to make them understand that it's separate. And so what it comes down to is, also in distribution intensity, is what customer are they actually going to take care of? And a lot depends on that and the product classification and the order size. What are gray markets? Well, the thing about your product is you can get knocked off. And that's that you're sold by non-authorized sellers. So you have one of two options. You can beat them, which is basically take legal action. The thing is, there are a lot of companies out there that take legal action, and it just takes years and years and years before you get any resolution. Or you can join them. You could basically threaten them and say, look, I know you're doing this. However, come work with us. And so the problem with that, though, is now you're bringing in another horizontal into the mix, and now all the other horizontals are going to get upset. So in terms of startups, what am I concerned about? Well, when I think about distribution, think about first, do I have a product that requires information or logistics or both? The next thing I think about is, am I better off going with resellers or am I better off selling digitally online from my own website? And then think about, do I want direct channels or indirect channels? What makes the most sense? For my company, what conflicts am I going to have to essentially contend with? And what makes the most sense for what our startup is? And so here are some examples of startups. Under Armour, they sell shirts out of the trunk for many years. Oh, I forgot the guy's last name, but his first name is Kevin. Anyway, the founder, he didn't draw salary from the company for like 7 years. And the thing is, later on, what he did is first he tried to sell through physical storefronts, and then later on he moved to digital storefronts. He actually did it sort of backwards. Arvioli, essentially, is a biomedical company that makes test kits, and what they do is they sold online. And that's that. The thing about middlemen in the medical industry, considering this wasn't necessarily under strict FDA compliance, and it was non-invasive, that's the big thing. You're not swallowing anything, you're not poking holes in you. But what they did is they decided, look, the resellers would just take too big a percentage of the share. That's the problem with resellers. And so, or you pre-order on Kickstarter. And so those are examples of what startups do.